Will you pray with me? God, we thank you for your presence here with us, for the chance to gather with our church family, for the beautiful music that draws us close to you. And God, we thank you for your word. As we turn our hearts and our minds to it, we pray, God, that you will speak to us, for your servants are trying to listen. Amen. So a while back, I read this article in the Washington Post by Laura Knight about cultivating generosity, and it just stuck with me. I remembered it. In the article, Lauren tells the story about her son, and she writes, "My second-born son, Oliver, has this serious affinity for stuffed animals. He takes such tender care of them, wrapping them in blankets when it's chilly, hauling them on errands, baby talking to them when he thinks no one is looking, lining them up next to his bed and tucking them in lovingly every single night." She writes, "That's why when my oldest son, Milo, walked past a gift shop when we were out one day, just the two of us, I was touched. When he noted how much his brother would love that stuffed gray fox in the window." Lauren thought this would be a great lesson for Milo. He could learn about giving and gift giving. And so she told him giddily that they could go in the store and get the fox for his little brother, Oliver. They opened the door and went in the store. And you know what happened next, right? Milo immediately saw something that he wanted to buy for himself. And so he asked his mom, "Can we get this? Can we get this?" "Not this time," Lauren said. "This time, let's just surprise Oliver. It will mean so much to him that you thought just of him." And right away, tears began to stream down Milo's face. Sobbing quietly, he handed the money for the stuffed fox to the baffled cashier. And Lauren and Milo headed out of the store, both feeling a little miserable, a little disappointed. In the car, on the way home, Lauren tried to explain to him how important it is to give, especially to give little gifts to people you love out of the blue. "Giving is important," she said. "It shows people how much you care about them, how much you appreciate them." But Milo was having none of it. He just sulked in the back seat, right, refusing to talk to her and upset about what he had not gotten. So this incident left Lauren wondering if the act of giving is something that children, and I think maybe sometimes even adults too, have to like acquire a taste for, much like we acquire a taste for a particular vegetable that we don't necessarily like through repeated exposure over time to it. Perhaps giving doesn't always come naturally or easily, but instead requires like patience and practice. So our scripture reading for today comes from 2 Corinthians. Chapter 8 and chapter 9 of 2 Corinthians tell the story, or at least part of the story, of what is called the Jerusalem offering. Now, it doesn't say that in our passage of scripture, but let me give you some background for it. I find it really fascinating that in the Bible, we have this account of the Apostle Paul raising money for an offering. In fact, on and off for several years, Paul is working to collect money for this Jerusalem offering. He talks about the Jerusalem offering in other places in Scripture too, not just in Corinthians. He talks about it in Romans, for instance. So in terms of context, the Jewish Christians who were living in Jerusalem were suffering, perhaps because of persecution, we don't exactly know, but they're facing basically crippling poverty and hardship, and they are in desperate need. They are hurting. They're going hungry. They are in need. So Paul goes out and makes this plea to the Gentile Christian churches throughout the Roman Empire to take up an offering for Jerusalem. So that's what he's doing in chapter 8 and chapter 9 of 2 Corinthians. And I was thinking this week as I was reading these passages of scripture about how it's really hard to talk about money. And it's really, really hard to talk about money in like a gracious and sensitive way while at the same time being honest and forthright. And I find it fascinating that Paul, who is a straight shooter, if ever there was a straight shooter in the history of straight shooters, seems to have a hard time in these two chapters just saying what he means. It's like he kind of dances around the issue. He hesitates as he tries to give this like theological pep talk to the Corinthians about this Jerusalem offering. On the one hand, Paul doesn't want them to give for the wrong reasons, and he doesn't want to coerce them to give. But on the other hand, he really, really, really wants them to give, and he believes they should give. So he spends two chapters talking about why they should give, but he does it in this kind of meandering way. He begins by talking about churches in Macedonia. And you're kind of like, what, Paul? Macedonia? Macedonia is this region in northern Greece. And during his second missionary journey, Paul planted churches in Macedonia. I think, in fact, the church at Thessalonica, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, is one of those churches. Intriguingly, Greece, Macedonia, just happens to be this long-standing political rival of Corinth. So Paul says, those churches in Macedonia, hint, hint, your political rivals, they were going through a terrible time. They were suffering from extreme poverty, but from the depths of their poverty, the Macedonians overflowed with generosity. They gave to the Jerusalem offering far more than they could afford. Corinth is known as a very wealthy area. Paul's essentially saying, look what you're rivals did. Look how they gave. Then it's like Paul feels like he's gone too far and he backs off. And in verse 8 he says, I'm not trying to order you around, command you to give, he says, but by bringing up the Macedonians, I'm hoping to bring out the best in you. He's trying to encourage them without dictating to them. He's trying to spur them on towards generosity, but he doesn't quite know how to do it. He reminds them then that they actually committed already to give to the offering. In verse 6 it says, complete this generous undertaking. In other words, you already said you were going to give. Stop procrastinating. Follow through with your commitment, won't you? But he doesn't want to come right out and say it to them. Laura Knight wants her son Milo to learn how great it can feel to give. She wants Milo to learn about the excitement and anticipation of giving to someone you love, to see the look of joy and surprise on their face. She wants Milo to learn to give generously. But when they arrive home, Milo is still mad because he didn't get the toy he wanted. So he walks up to Oliver and hands him the fox and says, I'm glad you're my brother. And then he turns and heads upstairs to his room to sulk a little bit more. Maybe giving doesn't always come naturally or easily to all of us. Paul really wants the Corinthian Christians to give. He wants them to give because the church in Jerusalem needs their gifts. There is a need, and they've already promised to give. But more importantly to that, Paul says in verse 9, for you know the generous act of the Lord Jesus Christ, and though he was rich, yet he became poor for your sake. In other words, he says, don't just give because of those things. Look at what Jesus did for you. Don't give because you want to outdo your rivals. Don't give because I've commanded you to give. Don't give for the wrong reasons. Give because of what God has done for you. It's like Paul is saying, giving doesn't come naturally or easily, but give because it's the only appropriate response to all that God has given to you. Lauren was really disappointed that Milo just handed his little brother the fox and then went upstairs. But later that evening, Milo came downstairs, and Oliver ran up to him and began to just inundate him with praise and gratitude like only a little brother can. Oliver kept saying, "Thank you so much, Milo. I love it." And he was smiling and gushing over this adorable little fox. Lauren writes, "I sensed this softening around Milo's edges, and eventually I even caught him smiling as he watched his little brother swaddle his cherished new toy." So giving may not always be our first or most natural instinct. And I can tell you, for me, it probably isn't. I think some people are more naturally generous than others. In the beginning, I think it can hurt a little bit to give. It takes practice to give, but eventually it feels good to give, which is why we call giving a spiritual discipline. It's a spiritual practice that we must cultivate. It's our calling as Christians to bless others, to serve, to give, to have this generousness that just wells up from inside of us, from the place where Christ lives. It's our response to God's grace and to God's love. But I believe that we have to learn how to give by practicing giving. And eventually, we experience the joy of it. So during the month of November, every year we ask the First Baptist family to give, to turn in a pledge card that commits, that lets us know what you're going to give for the next year in 2020. We pledge because the church belongs to each of us, and we share in the ownership of it. We pledge because we know that our worship and our music ministry blesses and heals people. We pledge because we know that we have a beautiful building that we have to maintain and keep up. And we pledge because we know this building is a gift to our community. We host all kinds of events here and 25 concerts per year. And our pledges help all of that happen. We pledge because we know that Kids Camp and Parents Night Out and Children's Sunday School and the Child Development Center and our student ministry enriches the lives of children and youth and their families. We pledge because we know that the money we give to First Baptist goes out from here to Voluntary Action Center and the food bank and to missionaries, and it spreads God's love all around this community and the world. And we pledge because of our personal experience. We know that our lives have been changed and blessed by this place. Something we've heard here or learned here or felt here or were involved in here has made a huge difference in our lives. We pledge because God has blessed us through this church. Our church covenant, which we read earlier, says, "We covenant together to sustain our common mission by proportionate giving." We know that means that there is a diversity of economic situations in our church, and we value diversity. It's one of our core values. We know then that some of us can give less and some of us can give more. The benchmark for giving isn't a certain number or a certain percentage. The benchmark is generosity. Proportionate giving for each of us. But the truth is, giving generously, I think, doesn't always come naturally or easily. It takes practice. It's a spiritual discipline. So in 1994, Mother Teresa spoke at the National Prayer Breakfast in Washington, D.C., 8 times during that speech, she said, "Give until it hurts." She talked about how giving should have this edge of sacrifice. "Give until it hurts," she says. She talked about how giving is easier for some people than others. Give until it hurts, she said. In the beginning, giving may hurt, especially if you've never given or if you've never really given. But at the very end of Mother Teresa's speech, she said, give until it hurts with a smile. I think that's what St. Paul is getting at in 2 Corinthians, because he kind of ends his argument with the phrase, for God loves a cheerful giver. So don't just give until it hurts. Practice giving until it feels good to give. That's the lesson Milo learned. And it's, I think, the lesson that God calls all of us to learn. So today, I invite you to pledge to give, because it's a joy to give back to God and to this church that's given us so much. Amen. So in just a moment, we're going to participate in our annual pledge walk. As Michael indicated earlier, you will have a chance to do this at other times next week if you didn't bring your card or didn't talk about it with your family. But I invite you to take just a moment, think about what you might give to fill out your pledge card. And the basket is here, and we will stand in just a moment and say our litany, and we will come forward and place our cards in the basket. Stand and join me in the litany, and then when you're able and ready, you can come up and place your card in the basket. This is the time where we make our love visible by promising the gifts of our time, talent, energy, and pledges. So as you're able, let's give.
I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will.
And then we're going to sing together. Generous God, over and over your grace sustains us. Over and over your love provides for us. Over and over your arm steadies us. Over and over what we need is here. We give you these gifts with gratitude and joy, thankful that you are God over all. Amen.